Hello children, welcome to the YouTube channel. I am Dakshaini, your biology teacher from Bharathastar Vetrick Higher Secondary School, Arakkonam. Children, today we are going to see 9th standard biology chapter 5. The chapter name is pollination and fertilization. What we discussed in the previous session, children, the first we discussed about the cross pollination, we discussed about cross pollination. So I will ask you one question. What is cross pollination? If the anthers of one flower is transferred to the stigma of the another flower, it is said to be the cross pollination. Yes. So what are, or next we discussed, what are all the factors that favors the cross pollination? What are all the types of what are all the factors that is responsible for cross pollination? And next one we discussed about the advantages and disadvantages. Advantages and disadvantages. In this session, we are going to discuss about the various agents of pollination. We studied that cross pollination, it requires some agents, because like self pollination, it is not possible a single flower can pollinate. Here it requires some agents such as wind, some non-living agents as well as some of the living agent. So we are going to discuss one by one. Children, now we are going to discuss about the abiotic factor. Abiotic factor. So what do you mean by abiotic? Biotic means living. Abiotic means non-living. So what are all the non-living factors responsible for pollination? So in this flower, what type of pollination takes place? The pollination takes place through the wind. So the pollination through wind, we can say it as anemophily. Anemophily. So one more question, children. The pollination by wind is anemophily. Next one, here it is a water plant and the pollination takes place through the water. So hydrophily. Hydro means water, right? So hydrophily. Children, now we are going to see about the biotic agents. What do you mean by biotic? Biotic means living. So what are all the living agents responsible for pollination? So first one is the insect pollination. You can see a flower being pollinated by a butterfly, right? It's an insect. So entomophily. Entomophily. Next one, a pollination by birds. Pollination by birds, study of birds, we call it as ornithology. So ornithophily. Ornithophily. The pollination by birds is cryptophily. Cryptophily. Next one, the pollination through the snail. The study of snails, malacmology. So malacophily. Pollination by snails, we say it as malacophily. So far we discussed about the different agents, that is the abiotic and the biotic agents. In the first one, we are going to discuss about the entomophily. What is entomophily? Pollination by insects, right? It's entomophily. So now we are going to discuss about the characteristics of the entomophilous flowers. What is entomophilous flowers? The flowers which are pollinated by the insects, we say it as the entomophilous flowers. So to attract the insects, the flower should be colorful. The flower should be very colorful, attractive, and it should be large. It should be large and very colorful, and it should possess nectars, because nectars will be the reward to the insects which visit the flower. So it should possess nectar glands. the another characters of the entomophilous flowers is some flowers, the flowers are inconspicuous, that is it is not very attractive. But the other structures, for example, it's a bougainvillea, kagidapu we say in Tamil, you can see the bracts are very colorful. This pink color portion is a bracts. Inside you can see, you know, this is a flowers. The flowers are very conspicuous, not clear. But the bracts are very attractive. So the insects are attracted towards this flower. So what is the example, children? Bougainvillea. Bougainvillea is an example for entomophilous flower. Another thing you can see, this is a pansy flower. What is this, children? Pansy. It is a pansy flower. Here you can see the stripes on the flower, right? Can you see? This is stripes. Why it is present? These stripes serves as a nectar guides. Nectar guides, which attract the insect to collect the nectar. Hence, the pollen grains are dusted on the insects. So it is transmitted to the another flower. So pansy flowers, what they possess, children? They possess nectar guides. Next, the another thing is the entomophilous flowers. Another characters is that some, I told you that the flowers must be large, but some flowers are very small. So such flowers appear as inflorescence. For example, the best example for inflorescence is sunflower. It possesses two types of florets. It is a ray florets, and in center what is present? Disc florets are present. So inflorescence, some flowers appears in inflorescence. Since the flowers are very small, they appear in groups. So some other characters of the entomophilous flowers is that the pollen grains must be rough, or it should be sticky. Why it should be sticky? Then only it will be easily sticking to the legs or the wings of the insects. So automatically when they visit the flower to collect the nectars, the pollen grains stick into the body of the insects, and it is automatically transferred to the another flower. So far we have discussed about the characteristics of the entomophilous flowers. So now we are going to study another example for insect pollinated flower, that is a sweet pea. What is the scientific name of sweet pea, children? Lathyrus. Lathyrus is a scientific name of sweet pea. And here you can see it is pollinated by a bee. And the shape of the flower is butterfly shaped, right? And it possesses the nectars. When the insect comes to collect the nectars, the pollen grains are dusted on the back of the bee. So now let us study the structure of the flower. So it is a structure of the Lathyrus flower, that is a sweet pea, children. Here what is this? It is a calyx, right? Calyx. And calyx is made up of sepals. Sepals, right? And petals. It consists of 5 petals, and the 5 petals, the first one is a standard petal. Standard petal, right? And it another 2 petals are keel petals. The 2 lateral petals, we can say it as a wing petals, like the shape of the wings. Next one, the petal which is present inside 2 petals, we say it as a keel petal. So how many standard petals, children? Standard petal 1, wing petal 2, and then keel petal 2. So totally how many petals? 5 petals. The arrangement of the flower is like a trough. Just underline in your book, what do you mean by trough? Trough is a structure which the cattle are used to feed water. Like totti we say in Tamil. Like that the flowers are arranged to protect the stamens and the gynoecium present inside. So the floral parts of the sweet pea is arranged like a trough. And the flower is zygomorphic. Zygomorphic means If the flowers are like this, it can be divided into equal parts from only one plane. So, zygomorphic. So, we studied about the arrangement of the calyx. Next, about the petals. That is the corolla. And now, we are going to see about the essential organs, that is the andrecium and gynoecium. Here, it consists of 10 stamens. 10 stamens. Out of 10 stamens, the 9 stamens are fused. The 9 stamens are fused to form a staminal tube. But one is free. One is free. So, this is a free stamen. The stamens 9 plus 1 pattern. Next one is a gynoecium. Gynoecium is located inside. It consists of ovary, style and then the stigma. So, this is the structure of the flower of sweet pea. The next we are going to discuss about the pollination by wind. What is pollination by wind called, children? Anemophily. So, that now we are going to discuss some of the important characteristics of the anemophilous flowers. Right? Anemophilous means it has to be carried out by the wind. Just imagine how the flower should be. If it has to be carried out by the wind, the flower should be pendulous. What means the pendulous? Yes. If it is a branch, the flower should be in such a position, right? So that when the wind blows, automatically the pollen grains are carried away. So flower should be pendulous. And some other important characteristics, that the pollen grain should be small. Pollen grain should be small so that it is easily carried out by the wind. The pollen grain should be dry. The pollen grain should be dry. It's a contrasting, children. In entomophilus, we studied the pollen grain should be sticky. But in the anemophilus flower, the pollen grain should be dry so that it would be easily carried out by the wind. And here, we have the best example for anemophilus flower is a maize. Maize plant. I told you the maize plant, it bears a male inflorescence on the top. So, this is also another character. The flower should be on the terminal position of the plant. So, that what will happen when the wind blows? What happens if the pollen grains are hidden in the leaves? Wind cannot carry it, right? So, the pollen grains are seen on the terminal portion of the plant. So, that it may be easily carried out by the wind. So, just imagine how the pollen grains takes place in the maize. Here, the male inflorescence is present on the top and the female, there is a corm, is on the bottom, is present on the axil of the leaves. So, you see the female flower possesses a silky stigma. If you buy a corn, before if you open that outside structure, you can see many hair-like projections, right? So, that is a stigma. So, what happens? This stigma is very silky and feathery. So, automatically when the wind blows, for example, if the wind blows, what happens? The plant shakes and automatically the pollen grains are transferred to the stigma. The pollen grains are transferred to the sticky, silky stigma. Thus, the cross-pollination takes place. So, this is an image how the cross-pollination takes place in the maize. That is, the pollen grains from this plant are transferred to the, when the wind blows, it is automatically transferred to the cob of the another plant. Self-pollination is also possible in the anemophilous flowers. So, children, what are all the things we discussed? We discussed about the agents. In that, we discussed about the biotic as well as the abiotic agents. In that, first we discussed about the entomophily. Entomophily is a pollination by insects. And what are all the characteristic features of the entomophily? And next we studied about the anemophily. Anemophily is a pollination by wind. So, after studying this chapter, after studying this entomophily and anemophily, you should be able to compare and contrast the both. They may ask you the difference. What differentiate entomophily and anemophily? You should be able to write it. So, this is the assessment related to this topic, children. It is given in the description. With this session comes to an end. Go through the topic well. write the characteristics of the entomophilus and the anemophilus flowers in your notebook. Thank you, children. Have a nice day.